I want to begin with some stuff, and while I'm doing it, I want you to open up your Bible. You need to open up your Bible. Grab a Bible, find the time, take it. There's pew Bibles there, and you need to turn to Matthew 10. I think that's around page 5 of the New Testament section of your pew Bible. While you're doing that, you can daydream during my sermon, not listen to me, and look at the text, okay? I want you to know it's page 8, okay? I find that this is helpful because there is some tough teaching in this text that we need to do. I want to begin with that tough story. It's about a husband and wife. They're on the 9th green. They're golfing. When suddenly she collapses from a heart attack. So husband and wife, this is serious stuff. She has a heart attack on the 9th. And she groans and says, "Help me, dear." The husband calls 911 on his cell phone, talks for a few minutes, and then he picks up his putter and lines up his putt, and he starts getting at it again. And she's lying on the green. And, "Honey, tell me what's going on here." He said, "It's okay. I just phoned, and there's a doctor coming. Don't worry about it." He's down around the 2nd. He's on the golf course, and he'll be coming. "Well, how long's he going to be?" He says, "Don't worry, honey. Everyone's agreed to just let him play through." Now, if you're a golfer, you get that. If you're not a golfer, you might not get that, okay? What is sad about that story is that golfers are weird. And they get, there's something single-minded about them. And that's one of the things I want you to grasp today. As brutal as the story is, there is something very single-minded about golfers. I am a bad golfer. Is that clear? Can I just get that out there? I am a bad to poor golfer, and I have a bug in me, and I love the game. And I often wonder why it is I love something that I do so poorly. I don't know whether that applies, because I'm going to be talking about your Christian faith in a moment. And I love the Lord, but sometimes I do it poorly. Okay? There is a connection here. But there is something single-minded about it, that once you get this golf bug, could be a sailing bug. I think sailors are like that. There's all sorts of people who have these certain bugs. And once you get it, but I ask you this, how do we account for, do you realize that there is an actual station called the Golf Channel? I mean, think about it. There are sports channels. There is no baseball channel per se. There is no football channel. There is no, we live in Canada. There is no hockey channel. There's actually a channel devoted specifically to golf. "Amen," he said, okay? And the camera, the guys hit the ball, this little white ball, there's clouds. You can't even see the thing. And there's people watching television, watching golf. It's actually really dumb. What's that? It's on channel 78. She even knows the number off the top of her head. Okay? I mean, think about this. You've got a television screen with three golfers, because as the rounds go, there are a few. There's three golfers with three caddies. There's six guys on a green, a crowd of 100 or 200 or 300 people around the green, and you're watching this on TV, and you can't even see the ball go into a cup that I don't even know is there. I trust in faith that it's there, this little dim. It's very odd. And that's what I want you to get to. And the point is that people are so single-minded about it. They're really focused on it. Some might even say they're possessed, a possession. There's a wisdom in all of that. Guy just read to you from Matthew 10 some very difficult words. I'm not sure that you were able to grasp it. That's one of the reasons why I've asked you actually to open up your Bible to Matthew 10. I want you to just hear this once more. Just I'm going to read one little line of it. I'm at verse 34, chapter 10. Here's what Jesus says. "Do not suppose that I've come to bring peace to the earth. This is Jesus speaking, folks. This is the Prince of Peace. This is the guy we celebrate at Christmas when the baby comes and everybody is, there's so much goodwill in the air. And this is Jesus says, I've come not to bring peace, but a sword. I've actually come to turn a man against his father. Now, I'm reading from the NIV Bible. It's a little different, but you'll get it. A man against his father, a daughter against his mother, a daughter-in-law against mother-in-law. A man's enemies will be members of his own blessed household. Do you know what's going on? Do you find that difficult? Tell me, do you find that difficult, or do I not have a sermon here? Everything is smooth, it's gone. I read that, and I go, okay, we need to wrestle this down. Who is this Lord Jesus that we follow? Who talks like this? And I want you to understand maybe where that text really goes. Clearly, God in Christ is making demands upon us. He even ends this little section by saying that we are to pick up our cross and follow him. If you see that, it's there, 38. And anyone who does not take up his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. There is a singularity of thought, just like those crazy guys who got the golf in their bones. They are tough teachings. For the seeker to come into Christianity, but for as well as the longtime believer. Clearly, this is costly faith. And we are not to cheapen it by turning Christianity into some consumer religion. So this is how I ended my sermon last week. And I just want to not skate over it. I want to go here quickly. I am struck at how the modern church tries to reach out to people to attract them to life and to ministry. And so I said to you, are you concerned about your children? Come to St. John's. We've got a great children's program, and we will look after your youth. We've got a youth pastor who's going to do some work, or he's certainly going to do barbecues and spend time with kids. Aren't we great? Come to us, Marketing 101. Okay. Are you finding the world difficult to live in? Do you find reading the newspaper sometimes overwhelming? Are you having a difficult time making sense of things? Come to the church where God can help your thinking and help you sort through things. You want a good Bible study? You come here. We'll guide you. We'll explain this Bible to you. Do you see what we're doing? We're trying to... You want to go to Sobeys? No. I like the IGA or whatever. You're like a different store. It turns our Christianity into consumerism. And my job as the ultimate marketer is to try to attract you to the church. And there are days when I don't always feel I'm even successful at that. As I said last week, there was a guy who had a church sign. He read, I didn't know about it, but I read it. Guy says, we've got what you want, come and get it. What does that say about church? Ecclesiology, how we do what we do. Trouble is, there's very little in Scripture to support this almost supermarket image of the church. And I'm repeating this week, because I worried about skating over it too quickly last week. And where does that take us as we turn to the gospel? We are to be fishers of men, not keepers of aquariums, if you remember that line from last week. But Jesus is not so quaint. He says throughout the gospel, in fact, pick up your cross and follow me. So he's making demands. So frankly, I sense that Jesus sends us out. What he's asking you to do is to become mature and to be about the kingdom of God. It's not about just what we can get from the fellowship. There's a call on our life. And then, so I can translate this. Let me put this to you. This Christianity is tough. You may not be liked for this faith. And you will be misunderstood because you're a Christian. You may even be laughed at. Any of you ever been laughed at for your Christian faith? If you feel that that has happened, I say to you, That's your cross. You are called to pick that up. We should give thanks that we are not persecuted like others. Like the story of the man that I heard who was doing mission work in China. He got to China, he arrived, and was immediately arrested. Now that is persecution. We worry about it, about being mocked at the dinner table if we're with visitors and we actually say we're Christians and they say to us, "You? Really? Christian? What is that? Like, are you out of your mind?" And I've heard people in this parish say that they've encountered that. And I'm saying, I believe that hurts you. Doesn't that hurt when that happens? I may not be put in jail, but at the same time, I don't like that. And it creates this retrenched view of Christianity. We're not going to talk about religion, faith, in public, because we don't want to create division. I love our old prayer book. This is how it translates one of the passages from 1 John 3:13. It says this, "Marvel not, brethren," the old prayer book, "marvel not, brethren, if the world hates you. They hated me first. Why wouldn't they hate you?" I mean, look what they did to Jesus. So this is one of the reasons why Christianity is such a tough call. I call you to come and serve. I call you to pick up your cross. I call you to tithe a wealth, part of your wealth, of your time and your talents. And oh, by the way, you're a sinner. Redeemed by grace. But it doesn't sell well, folks. In a culture of affluence. Doesn't mean the culture's right. It just shows you what a challenge you have. And we need to be strong. And we need to stand and count for this truth. So when Jesus says, "I have not come to bring peace, but a sword," that is what he's talking about. This gospel message gets people upset. And when you're in the world talking to people, they may see you as a prophet. You might be speaking prophetically. They may not say, "Oh, this person is speaking prophetically," but you may well be speaking prophetically at your kitchen table with somebody, to the person at work who's sitting next to you, or as this text points to, maybe to your children who don't quite get it, and you're actually speaking prophetically, and it is hard. You're at the dinner table. You are being meek and mild. Not offensive because you've got an Anglican something inside you. And something of your faith comes out and the whole conversation changes. As I said, you don't go to church, do you? Well, trust me, people don't like prophets. Truth tellers create division. So last week, I quoted to you from T.S. Eliot. I fear that that great quote passed you by. My spirit went, "I don't think they got this." I'm not going to put it back up on the screen. It's just coming to me now. I'm just revisiting that. T.S. Eliot, who was ridiculed by his intelligentsia, he's a Nobel laureate, for God's sake. I mean, you know, this guy converts to Christianity and all his culture around him ridicules him. And he says, "Sorry, it's because it's truth. And because it's truth, I reside here in the gospel." Do we have that kind of resolve? He says, you know what's good about the church is the faith tells us stuff about ourselves that we don't listen to otherwise. Now, I love going to the golf club. But I got to tell you, at the country club, you're generally not going to have someone speaking prophetically into your life. Or at the bridge club. Or wherever it is you hang out. But I'll tell you, at church, the church speaks truth. The gospel speaks truth. And Jesus says that truth will create division. And in that truth coming is like a sword. And it may create division even between father and son, mother and daughter. And then he does all the other relationships. He's just making a point. Okay, he's using hyperbole to get the point across that it creates division. If you could, I will say something about prophets bring truth and God's word to the people. And you know what they do with prophets? You know what they do with prophets? They kill them, they burn them, they ridicule them. They don't listen to prophets. If you read your Old Testament, it's one of the reasons Jesus came, because the people of Israel would not listen to the prophets. I want you to put up a picture of Jeremiah. Many of you have probably recognized that piece. It's on the Sistine Chapel ceiling. It is by Michelangelo, and there is Jeremiah, and he is grieving. He's not just thinking, because he is the prophet. He's the preacher's prophet, in my opinion. I was mucking around in Jeremiah last week, and that's what brings it up. He's a preaching prophet, and this is what he says, chapter 20, verses 7 to 9. I have become a laughingstock all day long. Oh my God, I have become a laughingstock. Everyone mocks me. And then he says, and I try to not tell people, but within me is something like a burning fire shut up in my bones, and I am weary of holding on to it. That's what happens to you when the Spirit of God gets a hold of you. You start to see things in the world and the culture around you that will grieve your soul, and you'll go, why did I become a Christian? Because in the Spirit, now I see things that I wish I was blind to before. Now I have new awareness. Now I just have a heavy heart, a heavier heart. But we are called to speak that truth. And it will create the vision around you if, in fact, you are like him. Here's what the psalmist says. You can leave him up. But here's what the psalmist says in Psalm 69:8. I have become a stranger to my own brothers, an immigrant to my mother's children. Insults have broken my heart. That's the psalmist, 69. If you're ever feeling weary about being Christian in a world that's not, own the 69th psalm. And you will find a kindred spirit and possibly comfort for your soul. The psalmist understood what Jeremiah was going through because there is division. This is what the psalmist says. Zeal for your house has consumed me. Oh, I pray that that would be your heart. That zeal for the house of God, for the truth of this kingdom message. Let heaven and earth is how he ends with this. This is how the psalmist ends. He doesn't end in despair, nor does Jeremiah actually. Well, he says, but I end with this. I praise your name. I praise your name even in the midst of things not going well. And you will restore my soul, because this world around me will not restore my soul. Friends, it is even worse. Here's the one that has crushed me. I've been ordained 30 years. And fortunately, this has only happened once or twice, but it has happened. It is in the 55th Psalm. In the 55th Psalm, the psalmist speaks to the burden of carrying the truth in a world, but even in the church. So the psalmist says, if I can just, I'm going to have to paraphrase it. Well, maybe I won't. Maybe I'll just jump to the 55th Psalm. Let's do that. It's too good. He's talking about division in the faith community. So it's not just outside the faith community, but in the faith community. Psalm 55, I start at verse 1. Listen to my prayer, O God. Do not ignore my plea. Hear me. Answer me. Oh God. My thoughts trouble me. I am distraught at the voice of the enemy and the stares of the wicked, for they bring down suffering upon me and revile me in their anger. My heart is in anguish. I want you to know that that was the heart of Jesus. You know, these are the tough teachings of Jesus, folks. I don't enjoy having to preach this, but this is what the lectionary has before us. This is what we are called to explain to you. My heart is in anguish within me. The terrors of death assail me. Fear and trembling have beset me. Horrors overwhelm me. And I said, oh, that I have the wings of a dove, then I just fly away and rest. But here's the problem in verse 12 and 13. If an enemy were insulting me, I could endure it. If a foe were raising himself against me, oh, I could hide from him. But it is you, a man like myself, my companion, and my close friend. You see, Satan wants to divide us. So here's an example. Guy has become a friend as we work together. Today in our midst is one of my dearest friends who I've walked with for years, Orville James, rector of Burlington Square United, probably one of the largest United churches in Canada. God bless you for the work that you do. And Orville's a dear friend. Nothing would grieve my heart more than if you and I were divided. Or you and I were divided. And it happens. Fortunately, it has not happened here. That's what the psalmist is saying. Oh, if an enemy were insulting me, oh, I get that. If a foe were raising himself against me, I could hide from him. But it is you, a man like myself, my companion, my close friend, with whom I once enjoyed sweet fellowship as we walked with the throng at the house of God. Division happens. Jesus brings the sword. And it's hard for us to hear this. But as you are devout and hold to the way, there will be conflict. And we have got to prepare for it. Because if we're looking for it to be easy, we've missed it. If we could put up a quote on the screen. The gospel is a message the world, by and large, does not want to hear. It is not good news to a world. The gospel, which means good news, is bad news, lousy news, offensive news for those who are of the world and don't know their need to be made new in Christ. It's my quote. I believe that deeply. This gospel goes into the world and is sweet, good news to those who are hungry for truth, for redemption. And that is why he will send the rich empty away. But it is the poor, the gentle, the humble of heart, and he draws them in. And that's why this gospel is so difficult, especially in a North American culture where we have so much. And I listened to the stories that Guy has shared over the last month and have been so convicted of the crowds of people and the healings that have gone on. And I am struck profoundly by the faith of the community, and they are by and large the poor and the marginalized. And the brokenhearted. And until we start ministering to that community in a fullness, I do not believe the anointing of the Holy Spirit will ultimately come in its fullness here. That is my prophetic word to all of us. It is hard to live under a prophetic pulpit, but those are my words. The university student comes back from school and says to her parents, it's true stories. I'm quitting law school. I've been listening to the chaplain at the university, and I've started to really understand this Jesus thing. I feel called to join an NGO and help the poor. The guy who told me that story said he's the chaplain at a very big university in the United States, Duke. And he says that the parents of the student come to him and say, what are you doing? What are you doing? I sent my daughter to Duke Law so she could aspire, make lots of money, and be part of the powerful of America. As though it was his fault. But the gospel got a hold of her, and she said, I don't want to do corporate law. I want to do kingdom work. That's what happens When the gospel gets into you and it creates division between parents and possibly children. In this story, it is the child that came to faith. I am struck, I will not say the names, but there are people here in this parish, in this church, right now, whose children brought them to church. They were going, what is going on with my son? What is going on with my daughter? I think I need to find out more, and now you're here in the church. God bless you. There is another person in this church right now, I cannot help but say this, but I'm not going to say their name, quite the reverse, where the parent and the child are in union, because and the parent should be so proud. Their son is a lawyer, was making lots of money downtown, working hard, quit, works as an NGO, is making 10% the salary they were making before because I think somehow the gospel is in that young man's life. God creates division. It turns everything upside down. If you allow Christ into your life, watch out. Stanley Harris says this. We put a picture of Stanley. He was quoted on at 9 o'clock. One of the most unpleasant men I've ever come across. Christian ethicist, brilliant, tough as nails. He was the only first Protestant ethicist to teach at Notre Dame years ago. The story about Stanley Harris is that the pastor, young pastor, comes to Stanley Harris and says, this Christian ministry, its stuff is really hard. There's so much division and people can be so unpleasant. I'm not sure what I've signed up for. And Howard's response was, your point? You thought it was going to be easy? Suck it up, buttercup, grow up, be tough, pick up your cross and follow me. He would not have got through pastoral studies at Wycliffe, okay? He would have failed. Okay, he's fired. But he was prophetic because he understood what Jesus was saying was, pick up your cross and follow me. I am asking for that golfer's singularity of mind. Is Jesus number one in your life? Because when Jesus becomes number one, as tough as that teaching may feel like, good things happen. I want to end on a more positive note or a gentler note because it's been hard to listen to. It's hard to preach this because I wish it was easier. And we could have gone to Bonhoeffer. We could have gone to all sorts of people. But here's this singularity of mine from Matthew 6:33. And if you were going to take down a note, I wish you would take this one down. Just one passage of Scripture. Matthew 6:33 is the famous passage where Jesus, in the middle of the Sermon on the Mount, or end of a particular section, says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, all these things shall be given unto you. Therefore, don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Get singular in your thinking. What is the one thing? You've heard me preach about that. I've quoted that business book, The One Thing, how businesses are the really successful businesses. The CEO got about what's the one thing we need to do to change? Because we get busy with everything else. Now I'm telling you, in your spiritual walk, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. All these things will be added unto you. So much so that in the midst of the turmoil, God will give you a peace that transcends all human understanding. And that's the good news. So I want to end with Scripture to encourage you, because you may have heard that the sword and I've come to bring division. Understand that there are demands. This is a costly grace. But this is the one I read at funerals very often. And it is from Matthew 11, 28 and following. These are also Jesus' words. Come unto me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. So I've ended with a paradox. Such is life. You're called to pick up your cross, and it may seem like a burden. But the closer you draw to Christ, as he is central in your life, mysteriously it has been my experience that there has not been division. There has been unity and a calmness and a weariness that is not mine, that allows me to continue on in faith, even though there are days when I just want to walk away, because it's hard.